Good evening.
Good evening.
Merry Christmas. Glad to see all of you here. Glad to see most of you smiling. Let's see if we can increase the ratio before this is over with. It's going to be a great night celebrating the birth of our Lord. Let's open up with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be here and to give you glory and honor and to recognize the central event of all of history, the night that you were born and came to earth as our Savior. Help us to, as we go through this service, to recognize exactly what it means, exactly what you accomplished that day as you came to be amongst us. As we continue through the service, guide and direct our hearts and our thoughts and our actions. Help us to be solidly in the center of your will. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, welcome to Grand Community Baptist Church. We are glad that you are all here tonight. I'm just going to give a word or two of announcements. First of all, remember that we have regular service tomorrow at regular time, so you can join us for Bible study at 9 and worship service at 10. And of course, there's a long list of upcoming special activities this time of year, so be sure that you sign up for what you need to sign up for, like the deacon dinner and those sorts of things in the lobby, and we'll be ready to move forward. Now, hopefully, I'm just going to give you a warning. Hopefully, everybody has one of these candles. And in a while, we're going to do the passing of the light. And in the passing of the light, don't light your candle until the person who is beside you or near you that would have passed the light to you. Let's say they were real candles and they're handing you a lit candle so you can light off of theirs. When they pass it off to you, then you turn yours on and then you pass it on to the next person by you. And then we pass the light through the room, one person at a time, from the front to the back. And feel free to reach around behind you and help the people behind you, too, to light their candles. And we will slowly light the room up as we go through that time frame. I believe that that is all of the announcements or words I wanted to say in advance. So let's get started with some special music. the lighting of the Advent candle tonight, we're going to be doing a special reading. So pull the little insert that says the Christ candle out of your bulletins. And I will read the leader portion of this. And then you and Miss Stephanie can read together in unison, all of you read together, the darker portion that says congregation. Let's go ahead and begin. In the dark and chill of a stable stall, and that cry sets the hearts of his parents aflame.
With wonder, with love, and light.
Though they alone first glimpsed eternity's call,
as child,
their hearts still rejoiced over the human birth
of their child.
For they saw in this babe so tiny and small, and in that dark, lonely place, they held fast to their dreams.
Dreams of mercy, dreams of truth,
so let us come once again to that stable stall. For in this dark, lonely world, we can hold fast to that cry. Do you remember an old commercial that there was a gentleman walking around and he's on his cell phone and he kept asking the question, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? I'm not quite sure I ever understood what that commercial was trying to say, but still I want us to think tonight in light of can you hear now? You see, humanity has a wonderful skill of forgetting, of overlooking, of not seeing that you are too familiar with. The familiar, what you interact with every day, you lose track of. So sometimes what happens when we celebrate Christmas and as we move towards the very special events and we remember what it is that God has done for us, it can almost just be a list of tick marks. Buy the presents, set the table, make the food, visit with the grandkids or visit with the grandparents or however the order goes, and somewhere in there you come to a Christmas Eve service. I'm going to encourage you tonight, if you can refresh your eyes, open your ears, and for the moment just pretend that you're hearing Christmas for the first time. Listen carefully to the words of the song. Think about what they mean and what they say. Listen carefully to the scriptures and how it all fits together. Because Christmas really is the beginning of God's salvation delivered to all of us when God the Son came and was born here on earth. It began with that promise from the Old Testament. Let's sing together, O Come, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, every one to his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
One of the things that I like about the Christmas story and how Luke tells it especially is that he anchors it in time. The Christmas event, it's very specifically placed. It's anchored in history. There are specific events that the world knows about that you can easily look back on that it's connected to. All of that is included in the scripture so that we begin to recognize something. Something that many people still deny today, but you need to know this. It's a real event. It really did happen. I'm always amazed when I come across somebody, and occasionally I do, who will say, well, Jesus never really existed. He's like so many other myths our world has invented. They're wrong. Jesus really did exist. He really was born in a very humble way. But even more beyond that, it was so much more than just a normal, ordinary birth that happened in this point of history and is documented in these ways. It is very specifically a human event. God the Son is taking on human flesh. He's becoming 100% human. He doesn't lay aside his deity, although he may lay aside some of the privileges of his deity. And from that point forward in history, forever on, he is both divine and human, fully both. Now, what that means is that from then on out, he has this ability to relate to God and to relate to us, to help to reconcile these two different worlds. And in that sense, what happened there was a divinely chosen moment. The very beginning act of a long-laid plan that's going to end in all of our redemption. Well, I say all of ours, and that's not totally true, is it? Because there are so many people that will reject Jesus. But we're here because we know him, because we don't reject him. So let's continue celebrating, and let's think about that moment, and think about how that moment was announced, in this case, to the shepherds that day as they tended their flocks on the hillside.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Yea, who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship,
Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men."
So I just realized a second ago I'm going to sound a little bit like a broken record. I know I do that a lot, actually. I say things, and then I say them a lot, and I say them again. And I'm going to say this. There's another aspect to this passage I really like. I like that Luke anchored it by talking about the census and who was governor and all of those specific events that can be anchored in. But in this passage, I like that it's that the angels chose to appear to shepherds. Why would that mean something to me, or why would I care about that? Well, because the shepherds were just the ordinary type of humanity. They weren't anyone special. They weren't the people whom everyone flocked to for attention. It wasn't like they were great world leaders. It wasn't like they were the type of person that anyone expected God to appear to or to make a great announcement to, but they were exactly the type of person that Jesus came for. Jesus came for your ordinary person. Let me just ask you a dumb question. This morning when you got up, did you feel ordinary? Did you feel like just a normal human being? You didn't wake up with any superpowers. You weren't tempted to save the world. You didn't suddenly have the ability to fly or lift a building. You're a normal person. You woke up also with some weaknesses, some regrets, some joys, but also some challenges. You're a normal person. You know what that means is Jesus came for you too. Just like he came to talk to those shepherds, and just like he came in order to reach everybody else in the room, he came for you too. And in so doing, he was reaching out to all of humanity in order to show them the glory of God. And there's a little microcosm of that desire up on the hillside above Bethlehem. When these shepherds, minding their own business, and all of a sudden they're surrounded by the glory of angels, the Shekinah glory shines around them, the hillside is lit up, there's a scary sight. There's a reason why every time an angel appears, the first words out of his mouth is, "Fear not." It's because this was not something people were used to, and it was not something that they could just take in stride of, "Oh yeah, look, there's an angel." It wasn't that kind of an event. It was the type of event that set you back, that made you think. So, the shepherds, ordinary humanity, out on the hillside, minding their own business, probably, or at least minding the business of the other shepherds, probably, they're confronted with the glory of God. And in the message given to them, it is an entire gospel message all wrapped up in it. That born for them is a Savior. Born for them is a Savior. That's still the message for us. Jesus, he's coming. Or Jesus had come, let me put it that way, in order to be the Savior, the salvation of all who were willing to receive him as Savior. He came to be the perfect sacrifice, the sacrifice that doesn't have to be repeated, the sacrifice that would be once for all for sin. If you want an interesting word study, go to your Bible software, or you don't really even have to have Bible software in today's world. Go to some internet site that has the Bible on it and search for once for all. And you'll discover that the forgiveness of Jesus Christ that was made available in all that he did for us was a once for all forgiveness. When I first asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior, I was probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 8 years old. And whatever sin I commit next week, Christ forgave me once for all, including all that future sin. We can sit back and we can kind of feel regret over our past, but Christ forgiven the past. We can feel worry over our future, but Christ has forgiven whatever mistakes we're going to make in the future. That was not giving you permission to make those mistakes on purpose, by the way. But it was me encouraging you, worry less and praise more. And trust that when Jesus came to be the perfect sacrifice, it really was perfect. So then what do you suppose is going to happen next? The birth has occurred. Jesus is in the manger. Mary and Joseph are aware of what's happened because they've had it all revealed to them. Maybe not all, but an awful lot revealed to them in advance. And now up on the hillside, the shepherds are told this, and they're said, one of the phrases, this will be a sign unto you. The implication of that phrase is, you're supposed to go look. They're given a task. So, they're being sent. And you know, before we fully understand everything that we're seeing and hearing out of the gospel of Jesus Christ, we're also sent. We are to tell others, we're to go see for ourselves, and then once we know it, we are to tell others about Jesus, God the Son, that came to earth to live the perfect life so that at the end of his life, he was ready to be our perfect sacrifice. So we gather tonight as a part of many others gathering to recognize this great birth.
So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said one to another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them.
When I was a child, I can remember coming home from school and watching TV. And they had this thing on TV back then, and I bet a lot of you remember it. It was called Schoolhouse Rock. And if you do remember that, you might remember, I don't know why I remember this better than I do most of the rest of it, that at the end of every single one of those little episodes, they had a little saying, "Knowledge is power." What I'm going to tell you next is that knowledge really is power. What you know and what you really accept and what you really believe and what you choose to invest your life in really is the power to shape and to control your life. If you will allow it to be such, information is power. When we had the gospel given to us in the form of Jesus Christ that came down to earth, it was a message. Yes, from a couple thousand years ago. But it was a knowledge, an information of God, an understanding of who He was. And now, if we really truly claim to be those that know it, we have to decide how we're going to respond. So the information is put in front of us. But we have to make a decision. We have to decide, will we respond to it? Will we accept it? Will we change the way we live? Will we tell someone else, or will we hold it with us tight? Will we just decide that it can stop with us? The gospel always requires a response. Now, for the shepherds, that meant that they've heard from the angels, and their immediate response is, are we going to go or not? Are we going to stay here on the hillside, or are we going to decide to go down to town? Now, leaving the sheep is a dereliction of duty, but maybe what we just heard about is a bigger deal than guarding the sheep. They have to make their choice what they're going to do. And, of course, we know they went to see Jesus. They wanted to see this thing. God had revealed it specifically to them. They've never had this opportunity. They're not known in society as being tied in with the things of God. This is a privilege that they never would have expected because they were just ordinary people, maybe even a little bit below the average respectability. And yet, this is who the angels appeared to, so now they have to choose. So they go down to see. And when they get there, it's just like they was told. The baby's there. He's wrapped in swaddling clothes. What an unusual treatment for a baby. He's lying in a manger. Well, once upon a time, they didn't really worry too much about sanitary conditions and medical events. And I don't think that this was a real clean location for a newborn baby. But that's where they found him. And a couple there alone. Well, not alone, surrounded by animals, who of course were all freshly bathed and smelled like roses. Of course not. Place smelled like a stable. It was an unusual place, but God had already revealed to them that the holiness of God was at work in the unusual place. In the normal realm of humanity. So now they've heard the gospel on the hillside. They've seen the gospel in the manger. and they've got to decide again. What do I do with this knowledge? Do I keep it to myself? Do we just let it be a secret among shepherds, or do we begin to tell everybody? Scripture tells us they went from there and they began to tell the story to everybody around them. I'll tell you something about serving the Lord Jesus Christ, about being a Christian, about being a part of God's kingdom on earth, is that it isn't a waiting room. Too many people think of the church as a waiting room. You come and you sit down and you worship and you pray and you just kind of wait here every Sunday until God comes back again. It isn't a place where you're to come and to be passively just sitting and waiting for Jesus to come back. It's a place where we gather together and we strategize and we work together in order to bring this message of the gospel to the entire world around us. That's the message. That's the mission that Jesus left us with when he left this earth. How will you respond? The gospel or the kingdom of God is not a waiting room. It's more of a passageway. And where one door was opened up because you heard the gospel, so many other doors now are in front of you. And step by step, God begins to use you in your life to reach the world that is around you. That is, as long as you had the courage to respond. As long as you had the courage to respond, to begin to learn and grow and to become what it was that Christ wanted you to be, to find your own places of service and to work in his kingdom. What personal response does Christ want you to make? You see, the rest of the gospel is that Jesus, he grew up, he lived this perfect life, and then at the end of his life, he was arrested. He was crucified. He died in our place, being the perfect sacrifice, the death that we deserved to die. He died for us. In just a minute, we're going to be taking the Lord's Supper together. When we do that, it's a symbol symbolizing the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Christ, he allowed himself to be put on a cross for our sake. But it doesn't end there either. To really see and to know the power of the gospel, know this, that 3 days later, he rose again. And that resurrection was to prove that his message was real, that he really was who he said he was, and that our forgiveness, our salvation, is truly available when we believe and accept him. I'm going to have the deacons come forward at this point in time. And as they do, we're going to take this Lord's Supper, remembering what Christ did for us when he went to the cross in our place. The Lord's Supper is an institution given to the early church in order to help us to remember what Christ did. It's written about in Corinthians, and I always like to read this passage whenever we take the Lord's Supper. In this passage it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Take note of how the bread and the cup represent the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It goes on then and talks about self-examination. It says it this way: "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and the blood of the Lord. So let a person examine himself, and in this way eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Today, if you're here and you know Jesus Christ as Savior and you're confident in your relationship with him, you are more than welcome to join us in this Lord's Supper. If you have some concerns, you have some issues, or if you have some younger children with you that may not understand, help them to choose perhaps to let the bread and the cup pass by today. We begin with the bread, of course, and we'll distribute that first, or we distribute it together. We distribute the bread first. Very good. Let's begin to do that. These are the bread? Okay. I apologize. I'm relatively new, and some days I forget what's where. We also have gluten-free available. If you need that, when we begin to distribute, someone can raise their hand and we'll be ready for that. Let's pray for God's blessing upon the bread. Father, thank you for your body on the cross, that you allowed your son to go to the cross in our place. We ask that you would help us to focus on Jesus and who he is through this entire season. Thank you for the bread and what it represents. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The second element of the Lord's Supper, the fruit of the vine, that is grape juice, representing the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's begin to distribute the grape juice now. Let's pray for God's blessing upon the cup. Father, thank you for the opportunity to recognize what you did for us as you poured out your son's blood in order to allow that punishment to be on him instead of on us, and help us to be mindful of what a great privilege it is that you loved us enough to allow your son to die in our place. In Jesus' name I pray. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Thank you, gentlemen. You may be seated again. So we have heard the gospel in the coming of Jesus, in his birth. We've heard the gospel in the sharing of the shepherds as they received the message and passed it on to others. And we have heard the conclusion of the gospel through the symbolic act of taking the Lord's Supper and remembering his death and burial and resurrection, what he did for us on the cross. Tonight, the last hymn we're going to sing is Silent Night. But as we do that, we're also going to be passing the light. So you may want to take out your candles and be ready. And as we are singing, I will move around and I'll help different sections to get started. And remember, pass from one person to another, and let's sing together. Let's Ethan, go ahead and begin turning the lights down too. Hold your candles up as high as is comfortable. Look around the room. The meaning of the passing of the light is that means in which one person hears the gospel, shares with another. And just as this light passed from person to person in this room, the passing is not done yet. It is easy for us to say, oh, everybody in America has heard the gospel. Everybody that wants to know knows. Let me just be real clear with you. There's plenty of people who don't know. There's plenty of people that don't understand the bits they do know. So keep passing the light. Keep sharing the gospel. Keep serving in the church and help it to be God's kingdom on earth to continue passing that gospel from one person, that salvation from one person to another. Let's close out with a word of prayer. Father, we do love you, and it's our joy to serve you through your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we celebrate his birth tonight, help us to remember that we're part of a chain, that we're part of the light, that we're part of the responsibility of telling others. Help us to come back next year with at least one person with us that we brought fully into your knowledge during the course of this year. Help all of us to have people with us that we brought this year. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you all. Merry Christmas. Of course, you can drop these on your way out, but thank you so much for being here today.